KMCH HD3 Detroit, KMPS HD3 Seattle, WBMX HD3 Boston,
and on AOL Radio
and Yahoo Launchcast. Psychic Radio is now CBS Radio's The Sky.
Back to Behind the Paranormal
with Paul and Ben Eno.
Call now
248-545-SOUL.
New SkyRadio.com.
Believe.
Can demons kill people? Can we unknowingly manufacture our own poltergeist phenomena? Are Ben and I too nice to Murray Silver? Well, hello there, and welcome to the 370th edition of Behind the Paranormal with Paul and Ben Eno. I'm Paul, and I'm afraid that young Ben is not with us today. The lad had all his wisdom teeth out on Friday. Yuck. And he is really going to take a few more days to recover, so we're missing him this evening. Actually, if you have a chance to go on his Facebook page and send him a few good wishes, he'd like that, I'm sure. Benjamin Eno. Anyway, this is an open line show, and we do those every few weeks to catch up on the enormous volume of emails we receive. We feel that answering them on the air can be informative for other people who might have the same questions. If you have your own questions or would like to comment on the ones we read, and again, because I'm all alone tonight and kind of lonely, please feel free to call in. The number is 248-545-SOUL or 545-7685. Or if you're listening on a computer, use the handy little instant feedback thing on your screen, and you can write to us. Okay, now to our emails. Now, actually, there were several questions. Someone called on the phone, something I don't encourage because I have no time, but people occasionally do that or will write in questions, of course. There is a form on our website, behindtheparanormal.com. But someone asked if demons could kill people. I didn't get the name or the place they were from, but that's a very good question. The violence of many of the poltergeist phenomena that I myself have witnessed and that others report might raise the question. Because I myself have been harmed physically by poltergeists, so notably in the Bridgeport case of 1974 when a young girl was involved and her parents, middle-aged parents, were involved in their home, of course, being a very small bungalow. People see it today on Lindley Street in Bridgeport, Connecticut, and they say, how on earth could anything have gone on in there? And now nobody have been able to pin down what it was. Well, it was quite wild, and there were all sorts of things going on. Now, this is the case in which I stood there with several police officers and watched the refrigerator lift itself up and put itself back down again, and the firefighters witnessed that as well. There were a number of other things that occurred, of course, and one of them was that a television set went over very suddenly and hit me in the leg, and I had a nice gash to show for that. The woman in the house, Mrs. Gooden, had her toe broken. A toe broken by a similar occurrence in this house. So, can demons kill people? I have never run into that myself. I think that because these things, demons, of course, being parasitical entities that we refer to all the time on the show, I think demons is part of the folklore baggage that they've picked up over the years because we explain things in ways that we can understand them. We don't really, I think our ancestors did and the shamans do, but most garden variety folks don't understand the notion of multiple worlds or the interactions thereof and that it's an open system and the energy comes and goes and that this can play funny tricks with space-time and with the anchor that we have on the ground, which is the sun rises in the east and sets in the west, and if it doesn't, wow. You know, so anyway, these are the sorts of things that we're dealing with. So we explain these things, these mighty and deep and vast realities with things that we can understand, like spirits of the dead being responsible for ghost phenomena, or with little guys from other planets being responsible for UFOs. And, of course, because of the ways parasites push buttons and get us going and in order to eat and to feed upon our energy, we say, aha, servants of the devil. They make us do bad things. All right, so this is something that has come down to us throughout our folklore and our history. Now, I think it is entirely possible that death can result, if injury can result, why not death? I have never really heard of a case that I can confirm, but Often in paranormal studies, one runs into people who are hurting themselves and perhaps even have been killed because of their own excitement and frenzy and fear. Now, if you start running wildly around in an old place that's dark or in an area that may have physical hazards on it, like cliffs or something, you know, it's very possible you may be seriously injured or killed. Whether they actually intend to do that, why would you kill your food source? I mean, they don't eat like we eat chickens. They feed upon our energy, and if we die, then we're not giving off any more energy. Although in the process of the phenomenon of bodily death, these things do feed. That's why they seem to encourage at times. We're going to get into this on another show, but wars and difficulties of all sorts that is. So I think it is possible. Although in 42 years of work in the paranormal, I've never seen it. Another such question came in that way, and it was, can we unknowingly manufacture our own poltergeist phenomena? Now, poltergeist, for those neophytes out there, are two German words meaning noisy ghost or noisy spirit. And this is commonly thought of as – it was thought of as a mischievous ghost in the past, and then – since the advent of academic parapsychology, something I don't really have an awful lot of faith in, frankly, although there are some awfully good people involved with it, it is generally thought of as the energy produced by an agent, or that's the term for example, in this Bridgeport case, the young girl, Marcy, who was 10 years old and had supposedly been producing this energy because of a number of factors. For example, she had been confined in the house for many weeks following her having been assaulted at school. Now, she wasn't seriously assaulted, but her parents were extremely protective, didn't let her do much. And, of course, here's a recipe for a lot of pent-up energy. Now, in my book, the parasites feed off that and are attracted by it and created the poltergeist problem. As a matter of fact, I identified four of them in the case, but hey, what the heck did I know? So most people assumed this was the agent thing, and the energy was just being produced by the little girl. So in that case, I suppose we could unknowingly manufacture our own poltergeist phenomenon if that theory is true. I don't happen to believe it because it doesn't explain adequately the poltergeist phenomenon or phenomena that I have witnessed. So I think another aspect of this question was, can we ourselves, while investigating a poltergeist situation, create phenomena? There has been some speculation that when the various entertainers on TV, the ghost hunting people, will go in and say, tell the quote unquote spirit to do something, you know, as if it's some kind of super being, you know, make the temperature go up or make the temperature go down. They have a thermometer. There's been some speculation that perhaps they themselves are manipulating the environment, something all of us are capable of doing, and therefore creating the temperature change. I think it is very possible that when these energies are present, it's not just the entities that are present, it's the energies that have allowed them to come through and to be there in these situations that I suppose could be harnessed by our own minds in one way or another. And to explain that a bit further, there are those who will say, aha, the ghost moved my keys or the ghost opened the door. Well, it might not have anything to do with the quote-unquote ghost. It might just be the electromagnetic energies that have allowed the parallel worlds to merge and the beings therein to interact that is creating the open door or the missing keys. Because why? It does. Electromagnetic energies acting in that way can do strange things to space-time. They can seem to manipulate space and time. You know, I think hence the idea that these entities are some kind of super beings that can see everything we do and everything, you know, and although I think that's kind of naive. I've never really found that to be the case. I mean, they're just as limited as we are in most cases. The parasites, however, being pretty strong in many ways, being the kinds of life forms that can move among worlds. So that being the case, we may manufacture our own phenomena. I think that deserves more research, and we'll pay more attention to that. It's a good question. Okay, so now to our emails. Okay, here is one. Okay, actually, well, yeah, we're going to be breaking very soon, but I'll get it started anyway. This is one for, oh, my friend Pastor Joe in Albany, New York. Whenever I hear from Pastor Joe, I'm usually in trouble, but he says, while your show is like a book that I can't put down, I have been a little upset lately that you seem to be going back on your own warnings about trusting and communicating with paranormal entities. Okay, that's a good point, Pastor Joe, and when we come back, we will discuss this a little bit further, but let me just read a little bit more. Until recently, your shows and Paul's books have all denigrated psychics and mediums, warned against communicating with ghosts and parasites, and put out a completely sensible attitude about the whole paranormal experience. Well, okay. Now I hear both of you talking about rescuing disgruntled aliens, planning an end-of-the-world party with people from other dimensions, and having long conversations in dark attics with bears and dead people. Oh, my goodness. Aside from the wide variety of life forms, aren't you just doing what the mediums you condemn are doing, channeling from the other side? Very well put, Pastor Joe. Very good questions, and we will answer them when we do come back. After the break, you are listening to Behind the Paranormal with Paul and Ben Eno, minus the Ben tonight, recovering from oral surgery. And we will be right back on the show. You are on CBS New Sky Radio and NewSkyRadio.com. We'll continue with our answer to Pastor Joe's question in just a moment, so stay with us.
Thursday is a power-packed day here on the Sky. Join us at noon for the I'm Thankful Network. At 1 p.m., it's the Dr. Pat Show. At 4 p.m., Colette Baron-Reed takes the stage for the Colette Baron-Reed Show. The Colette Baron-Reed Show, where intuition, practical spirituality, great advice, a little woo-woo fun, and fabulosity meet. Colette Baron-Reed is an internationally renowned intuitive counselor, educator, and best-selling author who helps others recognize and connect with their own intuition, potential, and purpose. Powerful motivational speaker, charismatic broadcast personality, and acclaimed performer, storyteller, and recording artist, Colette uses her extraordinary spiritual gifts to empower her clients to live a life that is awake and authentic, and to create a reality that is spiritual, deliberate, and meaningful. Call in early. The lines are hot. 248-545-7685. Instant feedback at NewSkyRadio.com. New Sky Radio. NewSkyRadio.com. New horizons, no boundaries. Powered by CBS, Yahoo, and Radio.com.
Sometimes, but everybody.
is now CBS Radio's The Sky.
Back to Behind the Paranormal
with Paul and Ben Eno.
Call now
248-545-SOUL.
New SkyRadio.com. Believe.
And welcome back, and we're about to answer a question and address some points from Pastor Joe in Albany, New York. Now, his Pastor, your points are extremely well made. You really express the reason why I, for years, did not write or talk about these what would generally be interpreted as psychic experiences. Okay. Running into various life forms in paranormal cases and being communicated with by them and things of this kind, and then talking about some of the more recent developments regarding times that may be coming, the communicating with these entities, the things they're afraid of too, just like us and all this business. So I'll get into a little bit of that, what we're talking about. However, you're absolutely right. I was very concerned that I would not be mistaken for doing things that I criticize psychics and mediums are doing. But I think the key here is understanding when you know or at least believe strongly that what you're doing and you know what you're doing, you are in less danger than if you understand, you don't understand what you're doing. I think that most psychics and mediums, although that there are some who are quite I think educated about all this, but and most of them think they are dealing with spirits of the dead or some other spirits, guides, things like this in some spirit world somewhere, and that these things will tell the truth. They a lot of them assume that they're being told the truth, and that that they can somehow be guided by what's being said or get messages from people who have died and give them to loved ones, and they consider that a really important ministry. Now, maybe that is what they're doing. Personally, again, I don't think that explanation is good enough. For example, you have all sorts of quote-unquote prophets who talk about their information coming from enlightened masters or from aliens or somebody. You know, how come they all don't get it from the same people? Or the same sources. That made me suspicious. So, maybe they're dealing with parallel worlds and many different ones instead of just one spirit world kind of thing. But whatever the case may be, I think that if you understand that you're dealing with a community of parallel worlds where most of the inhabitants, while they may not be like us physically or in many other ways, are sharing the same life as we do. And that's what I've found in paranormal research for all these years, not some spirit world, but many, many, many different worlds, most of which are entirely physical, side with ours, and that when our brain is, I guess, tuned to the right frequency, if you want to use that word, we can pick them up and we can see things that we usually can't see or hear things we usually can't hear because they're real worlds that seem to be sharing the same space and are all around, and sometimes they're not sharing the same space. So all possibilities according to quantum physics and all possible worlds are real, and they are accessible and actually indeed already present in our subconscious because we're living in many of them. So that's the point of view that I'm coming from. And it's not that I'm accessing some kind of super beings or spirit world or anything like this. So for what that's worth, I think when you know what you're doing in that regard, it's safer to do it. Although, believe me, I found plenty of things to be cautious about out there. So that is the second point, being cautious, being sensible. As St. Paul might say, discerning, since we're talking to Pastor Joe here. In the and of course, in the New Testament, St. Paul talks about not trusting every spirit, and also being discerning, realizing what it is that you're doing, and being able to tell whether it's real or not. These, as I say, when I first went into paranormal research, particularly in researching ghost phenomena, I would be very aware of very often names and people and places, and I rejected it. I wouldn't accept it because I didn't trust it. And I still am very, very careful. When this communication occurs, it is done in a state of sort of a very quiet meditative state. I never attempt to contact anything. There will be some contact with me by way of just verbal voices and things of this kind when I'm in the proper state. And this sometimes will not be in English. And there have been many times when we have not been able to communicate unless it's a language I happen to know. And even then, it can be a very odd form. I'm thinking particularly of you're referring to bears. Actually, I should explain what you're writing here. All right, so I do warn against psychics and mediums, yes. Warn against communicating with ghosts and parasites because the point being nothing in the paranormal is what it appears to be. It's what you were told, unless you really get to know these, whoever is saying it, and what the situation is. All right, now I hear both of you talking about rescuing disgruntled aliens. Okay. Ben and I operate – we're father and son, but we operate on entirely different levels here. Ben has – I tend to be more – well, I don't know if I should say scholarly, or I take a more intellectual approach to this based on my seminary studies and studies in psychology and all this business. Ben is – and I'm 59 years old. Ben is – a lad of 20, and he is a gifted shaman, and he's studying under a Mexican shaman, full-blooded Aztec, who lives fortunately very nearby, and so he's not like he has to travel far to go to interact with this marvelous fellow. But it's a matter of him operating on levels that shamans operated on, and I don't do that. I just have this happen to be sensitive to the people all around us because I have cultivated really all my life, when you look at the spirituality that I've learned, the multiverse awareness. It is perfectly normal to rub elbows with all kinds of different life forms in your daily life. Now, the problem is not to get locked up for it because our psychology and our alleged science don't any longer recognize these things. So that's where the disgruntled alien thing comes in. It was with Ben, not with me. He has, much to his own surprise, at times been approached by what you might call grays. And again, we don't really like to talk about a lot of this because it sounds so who are aware of the multiverse and want him to help open portals. Ben seems to be very good with portals, opening, closing them, moving. Portals being gateways between these parallel universes. All right. Something I don't entirely understand, but he's very good at that. And there are, according to his experiences, dissident aliens who want to get out of their own culture and ethos to a parallel world where it's better. So that apparently is what was happening. So, okay, so that's what that's about. And then Pastor Joe refers to us planning an end-of-the-world party with people from other dimensions. Well, I wouldn't quite go so far as to say that. We're not planning any kind of end-of-the-world party. This whole Mayan prophecy thing in 2012, I take that with a grain of salt. I don't particularly believe anything spectacular is going to happen on December 21st. As a matter of fact, just for fun, we're spending the day, it's a Saturday, with D'Irlon, the author we've had on frequently, and the author of the Mayan expert and author of Heaven's Wave, a novel of the Doomsday Prophecy. And we're going to just hang out on the 21st. If anything happens, okay, well, he's right. And then the following Monday, December 23rd, I should say, right here. Actually, I think it's going to be – I'm not sure which of our shows is going to be on, but we're going to have Dr. Chris Keating, the physicist, on, who has debated him about this. And it says nothing's going to happen either. So we're going to have some fun with this anyway. But we're not planning an end-of-the-world party with people from other dimensions. However, we do – interact with people from other dimensions. If you want to call them dimensions, dimensions and parallel worlds are not technically the same thing. People use the words interchangeably, as has Pastor Joe here, but within various worlds, there are dimensions of their own and things of this kind. It's very complicated. You should talk to a physicist. So the party thing isn't quite accurate. Having long conversations in dark attics with bears and dead people. Okay. I love how you put that, Pastor Joe. What we're doing here, he's referring to a case in 1975 in Yonkers, New York, in which I was conversing or communicating, again, of its own volition, with a guy who seemed to be doing the transition to another parallel life. Apparently, he might have his body was killed in a plane crash here, but, you know, again, the whole death thing doesn't really exist as we understand it. And he was going to the nearest convenient path of least resistance life, which apparently was pastor of a church in Virginia. And you can go back and listen to the podcast of those things. I want to go through it again, but I didn't know what the heck was happening because it was really strange. But since then, I have come to believe that this is what's happening, and that the experience has occurred several times where I've been communicating with them, and their memories will change as we communicate, and they're afraid of me because they see me as a ghost. This is how it works world to world, seemingly. So I wasn't quite talking with anybody who was dead because there is no death. Now, the bear thing was very interesting. He's referring to a conversation in the early 90s that I had in another attic, this time near Buffalo, New York. And it was a very interesting conversation with a noble, non-human creature whose energy came across almost ursine, almost like a bear. So I wasn't talking to a bear. I was talking to a very noble and a very positive being who was a neighbor from a parallel world, but he was on a quest. And we had to speak in a very odd form of Latin because he didn't speak English, and the Latin was very odd. It took us time to work it out so that we could communicate, and he apparently was on a quest for a place called Renthusia, or Renthusia. And see if several people have written in that there is a root in there that is the Greek word for sacrifice, and that maybe I was dealing with a parasite. But if you look at that word, thusia in Greek, it can mean self-sacrifice. And that's what came across from this particular marvelous being here. So in any case, that's what was happening in that case. I just don't believe that I'm doing what mediums and psychics are doing, because I think I understand what's actually happening. These are not spirits or guides or super beings. These are neighbors. So, like, I'm speaking with the neighbors, and when we get our ideas about what is coming up or may be coming up for us in ensuing years, that is a shared concern among these various multiversal beings we happen to encounter, who are just as concerned and in the dark as we are about a lot of things. So that's essentially where that stands, and I don't believe I'm doing what these other people are doing, and I will continue to criticize mediums and psychics for their attitudes and their understandings of this, or lack of understanding. And I could be wrong, but I don't think so. Anyway, we're going to take another break, and you're listening to Behind the Paranormal with Paul and Ben Eno, minus the Ben, on CBS New Sky Radio, newskyradio.com. We will be right back to continue with our open line show and our emails, so stay with us.
Take CBS Radio to Sky with you wherever you go. Be sure to download the Radio.com app today from your mobile marketplace. And when you really want to know more, 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 be sure to visit NewSkyRadio.com. Get in deep with exclusive articles and Sky News. Get your weekly horoscope and the inside scoop on host events. Radio.com and NewSkyRadio.com. Stay connected.
Thank you.
Radio is now CBS Radio's The Sky.
Back to Behind the Paranormal
with Paul and Ben Eno.
Call now
248-545-SOUL. New skyradio.com.
And we're back, and we have a rather, it's kind of in this business when you think you've seen everything, and then the next day, you know, there's something more unusual that comes along. And here's an email. This is from Megan in Fall River, Massachusetts. And Megan writes, "Hi, Paul and Ben, love all your shows, but I notice a little inconsistency when you have Murray Silver as a guest." Now, let me just digress here. Murray Silver, for those of you who don't know, is a very popular guest on the show. He is a Washington insider, a Hollywood insider, and a renowned paranormal investigator, although he's not that well known. He should be, because he has one of the sharpest minds in America. As a matter of fact, he's a big cheese with Mensa. So, and he's also a very dear friend of mine. And we have him on the show frequently to discuss many, many subjects. He's, as I say, an insider and a real Renaissance man. And that's who he is. I'll continue with this letter. "Very often when you talk about ghosts, your guests will be, as you say, spiritualists. Then you blow them out of the water. But Murray Silver comes on and uses spiritualist terms and ideas, and you spare him. Good heavens. I was really surprised when he was on last week and made a clear distinction between his ghosts in Savannah, spirits, and yours in the Village of Voices case in Connecticut, multiverse, and you let it go. Is there a little favoritism here?" All right. I can see where you'd get this idea, and maybe there's a little bit of that. I mean, knowing Murray so well and respecting him so much, I respect his mind. And as we're always saying on this show, and as I've said already on this one once, I could be wrong. I mean, you could do things wrong for 40 years or more, and maybe the whole multiverse thing is baloney. I don't know. It's just that is what I see out there with crystal clarity. None of the other spiritualist ideas like this spirits of the dead thing and the seance room and all this business has ever made much sense to me, and especially not now. So maybe I'm wrong. However, Murray understands where I'm coming from, and he uses spiritualist terms. I think that because that's what people understand. I think he uses them in terms of the multiverse. Okay, I wouldn't do that because I think it confuses things, but I understand where he's coming from. And I do respect the sharpness of his mind. So that's why we don't, quote, blow him out of the water. Actually, we never try to do that with guests. There have been one or two over the years. We've been on the air for 5 years now, all things considered. That's NPR, isn't it? No, all shows considered, I should say. And we have always tried to treat people with the greatest respect. And but there have been a few frustrating people over the years, but we still have not, I don't think, blown them out of the water. Anyway, we try not to do that in any kind of way that treats the guests with any sort of derision in any way. But I can see why you're thinking this, Megan, but I don't know. I mean, I hope that that's an explanation that you might accept. It's really not favoritism. It's more respect, I think, certainly. Okay, now we... Oh, boy, we're never going to get to this if I don't do it. I'll jump right to this. It's a question about parasites. Now, this is from Kelly in Seattle. And Kelly writes, I was looking forward to last week's show on parasites in human history, but I know that you postponed it in memory of your friend, but you did quickly name the 9 species of parasites. Can you talk some more about them? Well, we are going to do a show on parasites in human history, and we bumped it last week on our other station, on our Monday Drive Time show, because one of the major fellows at the station had passed away unexpectedly, or translated unexpectedly, and he also was a major UFO researcher in the 1960s. And so we sort of dropped our script, and we dedicated the show to him, and we broke our call-in record here in New England anyway. And it was really quite a tribute, we thought, to Joe Farrier, who was well-known for his photographs of UFOs taken in Rhode Island in the 60s and for his having published Probe magazine in the 60s. Interestingly, everywhere we go, and all the big names we deal with, Stan Friedman, Peter Robbins, all the different fellows who are major figures in UFO research today, they all heard of Joe Farrier, and I informed them that of what had happened. And it was quite a wonderful, interesting man and a true gentleman and a dear friend. So that's why we didn't do that show, but we will be doing it soon. But in the meantime, everybody wants to know, what are the 9 kinds of parasites I always refer to and have never talked about? They are talked about in my next book, if I ever finish it, which is just 3 years overdue now, so why hurry? Okay, now I seem to have identified, just to answer this question, 9 different species so far, and I rank them by their apparent intelligence, experience, power, and vulnerability. And I say parasites being creatures who are multiversal and are responsible for our folklore of demons and evil spirits, things of this kind. But what they actually are life forms, part of nature, who seem to be able to move between worlds. I mean, life is everywhere in the multiverse. And to feed upon what they need to feed upon in order to live. Now, it's possible that some of these varieties could be younger or older individuals of the same species, with their maturity making a difference in my presentation. But to me, each group does seem to be unique unto itself. I have every reason to believe that parasites do not all come from the same world, though they do seem to interact with each other, sometimes in a hostile manner. It's quite interesting to watch how they work. I considered naming them by class or something, but that sounded too much like Ghostbusters, so I decided to stick with their prime characteristics. And here's the list from the upper echelon down to the riffraff. The most impressive parasite group I've encountered, and from almost day one, I call the wise. Now, realize that term is used with great relativity and means nothing good when it comes to us. These are the top-shelf parasites, and they come across as very ancient and very full of knowledge about the multiverse, the inhabitants of our world, and of their prey. They give the impression of knowing our species far better than we do. They are conversant in most, if not all, human languages and have a great telepathic power. They tend to live and hunt alone. I always found that interesting. They're kind of like huge invisible spiders. And very often they'll quietly park themselves in a place or time where they have access to a certain house or tract of land for centuries at a time, picking up what knowledge they can and feeding on whoever comes along. These can be very difficult to deal with because they tend to have a certain arrogance and not to take us seriously. However, I have dealt successfully with them in the past. Then there are what I call the elders. Like the wise, the elders seem to have great knowledge and experience, but they are more apt to work together and to be leaders among other kinds of parasites. They do not seem as interested in humans and human life as the wise, except, of course, as food sources. That they don't seem to study us like the wise do. The third kind of parasite here that I talk about is the farmers. All right, these parasites seem to work quietly in groups of 4 to 8 and will attach themselves to a human family, tribe, or other community for long periods of time, cultivating situations and feeding off the results. Certain individuals in the parasite group might concentrate on or be in charge of particular individuals in the human group. In many cases, the parasites are so unobtrusive that except for feelings of presences or negativity, you know, the little basic haunted house stuff, the humans have no idea they are being farmed. Then there are the pack hunters. This species is highly aggressive, highly provocative, and will usually concentrate on one human individual at a time. Unlike most parasites, they seem to be highly mobile. They can and will follow a person from place to place. There is always a leader. If they get enough to eat, they can become poltergeists. I have encountered them from time to time in cases of possession and in exorcisms. They are also excellent mimics, and many victims become convinced that they are being paid attention to not by parasites, but by benevolent and protective spirits. All right, let me pause here for a minute. There are some common characteristics among all parasites that I've noticed. They seem to have gender, male and female. They can be killed, although I don't think I've ever managed to accomplish that. And when I say they can be killed, that's in the context of a multiverse where there is no death and they probably pop up somewhere else. But I mean, I've seen some really remarkable and odd things. Many of them seem to, especially the lower echelon ones, seem to, the longer they are attached to us or to our world, they seem to forget their own origins over time. It's very fascinating to watch. So anyway, moving on to the next group, there are the rogues. These are loners among the parasites, and they have many tendencies of the pack hunters, particularly the aggressiveness, but they operate in complete isolation from one another. They operate freely through Ouija boards and seances especially, and are very often responsible for poltergeist or possession cases. If you are silly enough to use a Ouija board, this is what you might encounter. One of these rogues will claim to be some king or prince or some big shot from somewhere. But in any case, we're up for another break here. We'll continue on Behind the Paranormal with Paul and Ben Eno on CBS New Sky Radio and newskyradio.com. We'll continue our discussion of the kinds of parasites in just a moment, so stay with us.
Mondays are motivational. It all begins with you. And that's where the Movement Within featuring life coach April Claxton comes in. Join April and her uplifting guests Monday at 6 p.m. Eastern Time. Featured on Animal Planet, Court TV, Unsolved Mysteries, and The Hauntings, psychic Barbara Mackey. Barbara is a sixth generation psychic medium, animal psychic, and spirit communicator. Tune into Visions with Barbara Mackey at 7 p.m. Eastern Time. There are four corners, and Will and Nancy will take you there at 8 p.m. Eastern Time. Existence is what we live for. Adventure is our journey. Metaphysical topics, inspiring and educational guest speakers, psychic readings, and more. Artie's the Party with Angels and Answers, Mondays at 9 p.m. Eastern Time. Psychic readings and more. Join the fun. What goes bump in the night? Heidi knows. At 11 p.m. Eastern Time, Heidi Hollis's The Outlander will lunge into topics on all things outlandish and more. Call in or write Heidi to vent or get advice about your paranormally inspired curiosities or challenges. Call in early. The lines are hot. 248-545-7685. Instant feedback at newskyradio.com. New Sky Radio. newskyradio.com. New horizons, no boundaries. Powered by CBS, Yahoo, and radio.com.
Friday night, I'm going nowhere. All the lights are changing, green to red. Turning over TV stations, situating my head. Looking back through time, you know it's clear that I've been blind. I've been a fool to open up my heart to all that jealousy, that bitterness, that ridicule. Saturday, I'm running wild and all the lights are changing, red to green. Moving through the crowds, I'm pushing, chemicals are rushing in my bloodstream. Only wish that you were here, you know I'm seeing it so clear. I've been afraid to show you how I really feel. Admit If you want it, come and get it. Crying out loud. The love that I was giving you was never in doubt. Let go of your heart, let go of your head, and fail it now. Let go of your heart, let go of your head, and fail it now. Babylon, Babylon. Sunday, all the lights in London shining, sky is fading red to blue. Kicking through the autumn leaves and wondering where it is you might be going to. Turning back for home, you know I'm feeling so alone, I can't believe. Climbing on the stair, I turn around to see you smiling there.
Psychic Radio is now CBS Radio's The Sky.
Back to Behind the Paranormal
with Paul and Ben Eno.
Call now
248-545-SOUL.
New skyradio.com.
Believe.
And we're back on our open line show answering some questions, answering one question particularly about the nature of parasites, of the nine different species of them that I have sort of identified for my own reference over the past 40-something years, and we've reached the ones known as the passives. This is a really interesting group, and it brings to mind several commonly known phenomena in the paranormal. This group seems to be almost like workers, passives, and they seem to be satisfied filling the role of second stringers. Very often they can be found with the elders assisting them or with some other brighter kind of parasite. I think of the UFO abduction phenomena in which people mention some superior aliens, quote-unquote, working with them, and then also a sort of worker class that's doing some of the other chores and things of this kind. It almost makes me think of this. I also think of how they can be sometimes cruelly treated, seemingly by our standards, with the elders or some of the other groups of the more superior kind. And I think often of stories people have of, oh, in my house there's the psychic told me or the medium told me that there's a mean guy, he's picking on a bunch of smaller ghosts and this kind of thing. Well, I mean, that could very well be interpreted as something like this, that because the psychics and mediums don't understand about parasites, that they might be, or usually, that they might be picking this up. So anyway, they seem to feed on, in a manner of speaking, whatever crumbs are left after the elders are finished with any particular situation. So that's a group. We'll go into more about that in the show when we talk about this. Then there are the lost. This is a fascinating tendency among all parasites to forget their own origins, as I just said, and even their identities the longer they spend attached to their victims. These lost often will communicate verbally with their hosts, or their victims, and they will often give the impression that they need sympathy and even that they are sorry for the way they have to live. I've actually had a case in the Midwest when one of the lost was constantly apologizing to its human victim that it had to feed on his energy. The victim could actually hear a human-like voice but never saw the parasite. But then there were the tricksters. Now, that's anybody who's into any kind of shamanism or native spirituality pretty much from any culture will recognize that word. The tricksters, I mean, if there are any species in the multiverse that can be intellectual lightweights but clever at the same time, it's this trickster species. They'll get the energy flowing from their victims through startling pranks and unpleasant surprises, and this is a common occurrence here, as many would say who have experienced them. And as with all parasites, their abilities to travel among parallel worlds will make it seem that they can manipulate space and time. Something that, as H.P. Lovecraft pointed out, in itself will strike horror, into the human heart, because what is more terrifying than a displacement in space and time? That's our anchor in what we consider to be reality. Tricksters are often the origins of the enlightened masters, space brothers, or false spirit guides that have a field day among gullible psychics and mediums, or other people, too. And you don't mean to just attack psychics and mediums in general. There are plenty of good ones who have an idea of what they're doing and have brains in their heads, but there are plenty who really don't, in my opinion. And the final group, the ninth group, is referred to as the brats. This is the lowest echelon among parasites and seems to be what I call, here's how they act. They act like spoiled brats and at the same time frightened children. It's a very interesting kind of thing to watch. They seem to live and feed alone on a specific human who is also alone. And often an unhealthy bond will result. I've had to wade in and disentangle several of these bizarre relationships, and it's an awful thing to do. It's one step short of possession, I think. And I think these things can create the phenomenon we know as possession. While brats are not very swift, they are very good at manipulating their victims, and they are terrified of being separated from their victims because they very often can't remember where they came from or where they should go. And this fear in them is really palpable. It's really quite fascinating to watch. So those are the nine species of parasites, to answer your question, Kelly, that I have identified over the years. And again, take it or leave it. I don't know. It seems to work for me. Okay, we've got only a couple of minutes left, so I guess I'd better forego this one. Although I wanted to – well, we'll do it on our next open line show. So again, to find out more about the parasites situation here and what their effect particularly on human history, we are going to be doing a show within the next few weeks on that. Watch behindtheparanormal.com, and that gives you all the shows coming up and past shows, 400 or so podcasts, lots of information about guests coming and going, and you can really enjoy the site, I hope, if you spend some time on it. Okay. Announcements. Now, Ben, of course, not being with us tonight because he had all his wisdom teeth out, he's not very good shape, will be speaking at the Grove House Hotel in Woodbridge, Suffolk, England, on Saturday, September 22nd from 7 to 11 p.m. The ticket price is £15, and it includes a full buffet dinner provided by the hotel. Proceeds will benefit local charities. Now, we're going to be arriving in Woodbridge the night before that. We're going to spend some time out at Rendlesham Forest, the famous Rendlesham Forest. And we might have a little time to hang out on Saturday before our presentation, which, as I said, begins at 7 p.m. So we will be around, and if anybody locally would like to, you know, come and meet us before the presentation, we'd love to meet you. We have a lot of good friends we've never met, and a big listenership, as I understand it, in East Anglia. Anyway, the evening will include a town hall meeting on paranormal events in this highly active area. Which was the scene, of course, of the famous Rendlesham Forest UFO incidents of 1980. Larry Warren, eyewitness to that event and co-author of the book Left at Eastgate, plans to be with us that evening, and we're looking forward to that as well. For information and to buy tickets, visit www.spaceportuk.com/events or just go to behindtheparanormal.com, our show site. Look for the link to that site under What's New, and we hope to see you there. Finally, Ben and I will be featured speakers at the All Hallows Eve Psychic Fair at the Crown Plaza Hotel in Warwick, Rhode Island on Sunday, October 28th. Watch for that and more info on that at behindtheparanormal.com as well. Check out my books on Barnes & Noble Nook and the e-reader and Kindle, Amazon Kindle, and be able to get them there. Again, behindtheparanormal.com. You can buy my books, check out the shows and things of that kind. So many thanks to our producer, Brandon Jackson, and we'll see you next week, August 19th, when we'll welcome British author Graham Nichols for a look at how to deal with out-of-the-body experiences, something a lot of people are very afraid of. In the meantime, tune into our Boston Providence Drive Time show on WOON 1240 AM and ONWorldwide.com at 6 p.m. Eastern Time every Monday. We leave you with a thought from Mother Teresa of Calcutta. Live simply, so others may simply live. Thanks for joining us on our great cosmic journey. We'll see you next time, and I'm sure Ben will be with us.